Hi ladies, it's Mae Larson here with Creating With Details. And so today we're going to be doing a quick tutorial on how to create this altered baby shoe pin cushion. And to create this fun project, you're going to need a baby shoe, just like so. This is the matching pair for this one. You're going to need some fiber fill to do your pin cushion. You're going to need some metal embellishments and some pins, and these are the 7-inch pins that I carry in my store, creatingwithdetailstore.com. And you're going to need some laces, some appliques, anything that you have in your drawer that you want to get rid of. You're also going to need some quick grip, and I use this for the pins. Now, to use this, you got to be careful because it does get kind of sticky, but it's no different than E6000. The difference is, I would say, is for some reason, and I don't know if it's the humidity, because before E6000 worked great for me, it did take a little long to dry up, but for some reason lately it's been gummy, like it doesn't want to dry up. I had a piece that had been sitting around for a couple days and it was like really gummy. And it never dried out. But this one works really fast, but it'll get on your hands, and so you have to work really quick with it. But it's a wonderful quick adhesive. You're also going to need, of course, your scissors, your hot glue. I'm going to use a doily to create the little puff ball that goes inside the shoe, and you're going to need your needle and thread. So let's get started. As you can see, I already have my needle and thread already threaded. Now this has a little lace going around. I'm going to go ahead and trim that, because once I pucker that up, it's not going to be seen, and that could be used for some other project. And so I'm going to go ahead and kind of trim that so that I can use that for another project. No, maybe I'll use it for this. So, like I was saying, if you have any metal embellishments that you want to use, go ahead and pull those out while I'm cutting these up, and start figuring out what you want to do as far as metal embellishments. Now, while I was doing my Hobby Lobby haul a couple months ago, couple weeks ago maybe, I came across some already made chunky charms. So that is what I actually use for this particular project, and that's what I'm going to use for this one that we're going to create tonight, just because it saves me some time. And they were fairly reasonably priced. They were at 50% off, and so why not use what I already have and work with that. But you're also going to need some beads and some spacers, just to give some accents to your pins. Now these are 7-inch pins, so they're fairly long. As I showed you in my previous video, they are very, very long. And what I had to do is, because I didn't want them that long, especially for these particular projects, I took my wire cutter and I cut the metal just a little bit so that I can have my pins a little bit smaller. So if you don't want your pins to be that tall or that long, you can definitely cut them up with a wire cutter. These are actually hat pins, so we're going to use that for something else. So that's why they're so long, but they're perfect for altering projects like this. So I'm going to go ahead and just go around the edge and start feeding and doing a running stitch. Now you notice that I'm not doing huge strides on this. I'm just, you know, doing about a 1/4-inch stitch in my running stitch, because I want a little bit more of a pleat in there. I don't want the huge long strides, because when I mean that, I mean like going all the way over here and, you know, instead of smaller stitches, because then when you gather it up, you're going to see that. So you want to make your stitch fairly small, so you don't have the puckering looking kind of odd. So you want to make sure that it is evenly throughout your stitch. And the good thing about this needle is that it does work really well with your hands. So now for my project, the other shoe that I made, I did use a piece of muslin, and so I just cut a circle, and it was probably about a 7-inch diameter, maybe a little bigger, but I cut a circle and I did this exact same technique. Now, this technique can be used for various things. You can use it to make your little stuffing for your pin cushion. You can also use this for your yo-yo flowers, as you saw the other day. So there's a lot of things you can use this little technique for. And you don't have to just make a shoe. If you're making a pin cushion out of a canning jar, or any jar for that matter, you can use this exact same technique to create that. So we're coming towards the end right now, and do that, and then do a lock stitch. I don't want to do a lock stitch yet because I need to expand that like so. I'm going to go ahead and open it and then grab my fiber fill. Now this is something I picked up at Walmart. Go ahead and kind of get that all in there. And once you start pulling, you see that? And gathering, it starts shaping up. See that? Now, you can add more, and that's why I said try to do smaller stitching so that it gives you a more even circled look versus having one stitch here, one stitch here. It's going to look kind of wonky. So the smaller stitching just gives it a bit a more even out look. If that makes any sense. So it's coming entirely undone. I should have done a lock stitch when I first did it, and I didn't. So this one here has to be knotted more. So see? A blooper. Sure why the volume in my camera is not picking up. I might have to see about maybe getting one of those headsets, microphones, so that you guys can hear me better. But see, it gives you more of a rounded shape look versus a lumpy look. So we're going for more rounded than lumpy. So kind of pull it together, and it doesn't have to be all the way through. And then hold it in place. And then do your lock stitch. There's that. Up so that we have them ready for the next use. Okay, so then the next thing we're going to do, I'm going to go ahead and take my baby shoe here, put some glue down here at the bottom because so it's coming undone. Got my little finger, I don't want to get myself burnt. Then I'm going to to go ahead and take some more of this fiber stuff. And I removed the laces out of these. And we're going to stuff it so that we get more shape in there, because they're, you know, the owner of this was in his 90s. And the only reason I know that is because when we were at the estate sale, we bought, these were a little dirty. They were telling a little bit of history of the house, and it was an old Victorian home that was owned by a three-generation family, and the gentleman that was living there before we, before the estate sale, or the gentleman that lived there that owned these shoes, I believe, he was in his 90s, and it was his three-generation of his family that owned that home, and he was being placed in a nursing home. So the house was going up for sale, or it was on the market for sale. So we're going to stuff it, and then I'm just going to go ahead and lift that up just a little and put a little bit of hot glue in there to hold it in place a little. And just at the bottom part here, and then just kind of push down on it. Once you put all this yummy goodness in there, it's not going to be noticeable, okay? So then I'm going to go ahead and put a little pin cushion in there, just like so. Of course, I'm going to put more fiber in there because I think it needs it. And it's up to you how much fiber you want to put in there. You can put a little, you can put a lot. And here I'm going to go ahead and kind of glue around the edges. Here to get some of this now I'm going to go ahead and kind of put some glue down here to help me hold it in place until we start decorating it. But yeah, the owner, he's in his 90s, and he was placed in a nursing home, and they had all these little baby shoes. I grabbed another pair, and I gifted it to my friend. Had these baby clothes, christening outfits, and I got a couple of those. For my friend as well. So once you have that, we're going to stuff that in like so. And then, like that. So we're going to go ahead and put some hot glue around the edges. Kind of firmly press on the sides of this, the shoes. And all your shoes are going to be different, so you're going to have to play it around with it just to get it to work, you know, how you want it. But once you start decorating it, you're really not going to notice a lot of this stuff. Get to see the crease here. I want to kind of, I guess from over the years of it sitting around, kind of got squished, and I don't want that. Thank you. guess, see, that's like a hard little piece right there. So I'm gonna glue that. Firmly press on that wall. Talking. That's better. Okay. Forget, ladies, that I'm waiting on one piece to come in for the monthly kit, and once that comes in this week, we will be releasing that probably Monday. We'll probably be releasing the monthly kit and shipping them all out, so there's that. Doily here, and I'll probably, what I'm going to do is cut around that, because I want that little, I love that little flower piece. Now, I actually didn't do that with the other one. I actually used applique. So, like I said, I always play around before I actually do anything. So, before I even glue this straight down, I'll play around and see what I want. And then we'll figure out. Don't know who I got that doily from, but we'll probably figure something out with this. If I don't like that, we'll use something else. Okay, so for the body, what I used was a piece of a wedding applique. And the first thing I did is you can take satin, and I've done altered shoes where I've taken the satin and play around with that, but I centered this arched part here, or the scallop part here, towards the center there, and kind of worked my way around up to the shoe. So I'm going to do that. And for that, I did hot glue. And my little spatulas can be. Okay, then I'm just going to keep working slowly, and we're going to do it in small sections so that we have good coverage and stretch your fabric. You've got to make sure you stretch out that fabric. Okay. And then we'll work on the side. Very important, and it's really easy because it is a baby shoe. Now, I've done it in bigger shoes, and it's the same concept. And see how I'm kind of stretching it and getting a feel for it? So, like right here, where I'm pulling, I have this little gap or bubble here. See that? So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go in here, put my finger. finger there, and I'm going to go ahead and apply some glue there so that I know that is where I'm going to be getting some of that bubble out. And then again, pressing down on it. And then working your way to the back of the shoe. Lifting up. And do your small little sections. Don't do huge sections so you're not getting too much pockets or air bubbles, okay? And then we're going by the edge here of between the sole of the shoe and the shoe. And that's exactly where I'm going to be putting in my glue. And see, again, I'm holding right there tightly where that is, and I'm flipping that over, and then I'm doing small little areas because we don't want to do huge areas and get those air bubbles in there. And I like using my little finger here because I don't get hurt, but I also don't get all that gook from the glue in my hands. So then I'm going to go back over here, see that? To the front. Lift it up this way. And then we're going to push it. And again, work in this little small area. This saves me from burning myself, and it also helps me get better seepage in there. So again, I'm holding it right there where that ends, and I'm going to go ahead and do the small areas. And again, it's just the idea of this is getting into pushing and stretching your fabric as much as you can. And we're going to work back over here to the front because we got to make sure they're evened out. Well, if you guys saw my other altered shoe, I did one in 2014. Now for that one, what I kind of did is I built on and had a small heel, and I wanted a boot because I couldn't find a boot. And I just kind of built my own little boot. Here we'll trim it out and, you know, use those pieces for something else within your boot. And stretching it as much as we can. And using our glue tools. Okay. And we're going back to the front. Of the shoe. I don't know what it's called, but I call it a tongue. I don't know what the technical term is. Pressing and pulling. Thank you. sure you could probably use Fabri-Tac for this project. It'll probably give you, just the hot glue right now is probably the fastest way to get it done. Go with the hot glue on this particular project. And then put a little, and now I have a bigger space here, and I can take longer strides on this. The hardest part is getting that front done. And the arches around, angling it through, that's probably the hardest part. If you had fabric, you can, like I said, satin, and then you can cut out your appliques, which is what I've done on other ones, my Alta boots. I've actually cut out a piece of satin and wrapped it around just like I did here, and then I started to build my appliques on top. So, now we're going to trim one of these, and I'm going to trim this side because we've met on both sides here. I'm just trying to be really careful that I can save some of this applique for something else. I don't want to damage it. Extras, so that's going to be used for something else, definitely for sure. And then over here, I have a huge chunk left over, but I'm going to kind of ride it over because see that goes right straight down that center line, so that worked out great. Extra mesh here, and we can probably tuck it down just like that, or we can trim it. And we'll trim it. And then I'll go back in and I'll clean the edges out. Is extremely important. So, now we have this, and then I'm going to go ahead around the edges of this applique. I'm going to trim around it carefully so I can pick up some of the beautiful detail work of this applique. For these kind of things, like this detailed little works, you need kind of like small shears, so you can get in there really good and get good precision. But you know, you don't have to be so nitpicky like I am. As long as you get a cut. As long as you get the job done. I'm going to trim around. Like I said, I will clean these edges up. And once I clean them, you're not even going to know that that was there. So far, we have our shoe almost covered. It doesn't really take a long one. It's not a long project. And this could be used as a gift to a friend or a loved one, a co-worker, you know. For wedding centerpieces or a baby shower, I would think this would look beautiful in a baby shower. You know, for centerpieces, I would think this would be gorgeous. I'm going to do this one now. Saves me so much burning. And then you'll have these wings, you know, and you could be creative and leave those there. I had thought about that, leaving some wings on my baby shoes. But I'm not going to do that with this one. I'll go ahead and trim around this edging, and you're going to have a lot of beading, especially if you have beadwork like mine here. That's okay. Lots of beadwork on this trim. Or applique. At this point, lift all these little edges and get really good into the edge of your sole. And I'm still losing beads here. My way down here. Take it back in the shoe. Going on with our shoe. And we have lots of little beads everywhere. Okay. So for these appliques, these beads are going nuts. I can take these and kind of lay them here, or I can go back to the idea of doing this. kind of like this idea. Just give it a more shabbier look. So we're going to go with that. Of these. Yeah, because we can't waste these. These are good pieces. And we don't want to waste them. I'm going to tuck that in there and kind of work it around. Puzzle when you're cutting these out like this. It really is. It really is. I need to get right in there. Start cutting in between the leaves and all that stuff. Start from the back and then start out just like so. Correct terminology it is, but If it's not a tongue, I'm sorry. That's what my mom called it. Some of these here edges, as much as I can. And there it is. See, it's not very hard to do. Simple. For the bottom edge, what I use is to skim, and again, I'm going to start from the back, and this is about a quarter inch gimp, and it's available in our store, readingwithdetailstore.com, and I'm going to kind of go around the edges just like that, just to clean up the edges. I had taken a copy of an imprint of the sole. I'm going to go ahead and I just basically put the shoe down and traced around it. I'm going to go ahead and place this on the bottom of my shoe before I do that. And it might be right and it might be wrong. I might be off just a little, but it's alright. Wrong with it. I'm going to go ahead and kind of work on the bottom of our sole. And you don't have to. You know, it shows character. This little kid, this poor kid was running on this one because it's the bottom is really worn out. But it had its wear and tear for sure. Take the edging and just go around the edge to clean it up a little. I'm going to start from the back. Right, straight smack. It was a long day. Long day. I've got another altering project. Once I'm done with this. And night, because it's easier for me at night or first thing in the morning. Before orders. Before I start shipping orders out. But beauty of these is that once you put all these little fine details in there, they look so beautiful and stunning. It's absolutely gorgeous when you finish them up. History behind it, you know, like almost walking my shoes. Well, you know, whoever walked in these shoes, he's 90 some years old now in the nursing home, and boy, he did a lot of walking, huh? Patchwork shoe. That's what makes it so unique and fun. That's what gives it character. It totally does. It gives it a lot of character. Do projects like this. Now, if you're working with a pair of shoes that belong to your child, I think that would be so awesome, because not only are you giving it a second life, a second opportunity, but you also have the history behind it. Your child walked in it. I wish I had some of my kids' shoes. I have one pair of her shoes, and my youngest, I have one of her shoes, but I didn't save them all because I had given some of my oldest to my cousin who had a child and needed some clothes. I kind of passed down some of her clothes to him and then his wife. And then with my second, my mom kept a lot of his stuff. So then we have that going on with our shoe. And we can go in here and probably give it an edging as well. If you want, you can tuck it in there. And that's what I'm going to do. So when my mom passed away, before she passed away, of course I didn't know my mom was terminally ill. I guess I was in denial. Well, I guess that's what I should say. I was in denial. And she went through a cleaning moment where she was getting rid of a lot of stuff. She didn't let me know if she was getting rid of stuff, and she got rid of some of my kid stuff that she had been holding on to. Which is okay, because she donated it to, you know, she donated it to local church, but I would have wished I knew so that I can at least have some, like, my son's always like, what are you having in my stuff? Ooh, grandma kind of did away with some of those things. Once you did that one egging, you really didn't have to do this. I just kind of wanted to give it more character and build onto the layering. Giving that layering effect. And layering does really make a huge difference when you're creating these kind of one-of-a-kind pieces. It really does. So I was like, and I was never good. I have never. Actually, I was talking to the ladies last night about that when we were crafting and I was working on these. I have never been good at doing a scrapbook layout, but it's almost the same concept. You know, with scrapbooking, you have to build layers upon layers upon layers, and it's the same way when you're working with shabby chic projects such as this. Okay, so that's what we had so far with our shoe, and then we worked on the bottom, and now I'm going to take what I did is I took this piece and I cut about 12 scallops. 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and I kind of ruffled it up. Put a running stitch on it. Now I have my needle ready. Before I did that, I kind of trimmed some of this because this is too long. So I cut it up until where the flowers meet. Stitch. I do smaller stitches again because I want more of a ruffled look. So I tend to do a lot more smaller stitches, but it's up to you on how you want to proceed this part. If you want to do longer stitch or shorter stitching. And I left about 3/8 inch seam allowance. The tongue, and we're going to glue. So that's where we're going. And we're probably for this going to have to do smaller tucking or smaller gluing sections because we don't want to miss your mark. And you also don't want to burn yourself. some stick pins. Probably do a second video for the stick pin so that this video is not massively long, because right now we're going on to an hour. Okay. The same. And then for the front bow, what I did, and you could do this yourself too, is I took some of the seam binding that I coffee dyed, and I just made a quick bow. I can find the beginning and the end. I would say about 2 yards, but you probably don't need that, because what I do is I double it up. And I'm just eyeballing, because I eyeball everything. If I had to guess, I would say that was about 2 yards. And you want to do even amount on your sari ribbon. This, my middle finger, these two middle fingers, I'm going to put my wire through there, up here, and then kind of grab it and twist. To hide my wire. And then we're going to come back and do part two of the stick pins. You kind of have to have stick pins. And I don't cut this little piece here because I think it just adds more character to the fluffiness and the fullness of this bow. So I like kind of like that. I just stuck that right there in the center. I'm going to do the same thing to the back on this one. a smaller bow for the back, because I don't need that huge chunkiness, and I'm not going to add sari to it. Too soon. Double close it. One, two, crisscross. I was just doing this, and I hide the little wiring of that, and then I, like I said, I don't cut those little, that little piece out. I just kind of think it looks, it gives it more character. The owner knew that I was making this into a girly shoe, he probably won't be too happy about that. And then we are going to come back for part two of how we do the stick fence. Okay, so I am back, and this time we're going to work on, let me try to zoom in on this part. I can get my cameras to work better. Okay, so I have my shoe, as you guys can see. I decided to go ahead and put a second layer here on my little tongue. So I took this ivory ruffle pleated trim that we carry in our store, and I'm going to add it as a second layer to the back of here, just to give it more of a flared look, a more fuller look, actually. And something a little bit different, because I don't think I want two of the same shoes in my place here. So we're going to kind of... The concept is the same, it almost looks the same, but we're going to have entirely different shoes as far as the decor part and the decor part and the structure of the shoe. We're going to try to make it a little bit different. So there we have that. So that when you're looking at it from this view, it doesn't look so sloppy. That's really important. So anyway, then as I was trying to gather up all my embellishments for my shoe, I decided I'm going to do a wraparound. What I mean a wraparound, I'm going to take a chain link and I'm going to wrap it around the shoe a couple times, and I actually kind of wrap it around twice. And I'm going to take a jump ring and join those two together. And I'm going to trim this because this chain link is really long. And just want it enough to go around. And I do this a lot with my altered boots that I wear, my Western boots that I will wear around town. I wear like little chains around them. So I think they give it just almost a flare like that. To these little boots, pin cushion boots. So I just kind of wrapped it around loosely, not tight, around the boot, and then I'm going to gather the two pieces, the two ends, and I'll flip it this way, with a jump ring, and I want to join those two together. Let me open up my right jump ring, and for that we'll need a flattening plier. Kind of twist it open. It on one end of that, and then bring this one over and join those two together. And kind of wiggle it back. Okay. So now we have a little dangling piece like that on our boot. And then I have all these little embellishments that I wanted to add to build character. But before I do that, I'm going to go ahead and get a couple of these jump rings and decide how I want this done. So we're going to go. And I have these little bezels. Like when we were working on the chunky charm, I wanted to do something similar to this, not too similar, but somewhat. So let's flip it this way, grab my jump ring, slide this through, and kind of put it in here in the chain that I wrapped around. And kind of wiggle it, the two prongs together. Some other embellishments here. Wasn't sure what I wanted to add to the front, but I'm thinking of this. And then I have this little chunky here, so we're gonna probably add that in there. And I kind of just kind of twist it, just carefully twist that. Two charms together. See that? And then I found a bigger jump ring. I thought I had bigger jump rings, but I don't. And then I found these. And we're gonna, what's it, chunky charm. On our boot. And then for the front, what I had thought about doing is adding this piece, but I need to snap off this because this came like that. So I'm going to snap that off. Oops. to this filigree that we carry in our shop, and we're going to go to the front just like that. For that, I'm going to go ahead and use this quick dry glue. Get that in there, and then I'm going to set that aside so that it dries up before I even work around it. Okay, so we're going to leave this here drying. And these are these timeline, Gilded Age timeline embellishments. Now, for our stick pins, what I did is here's the 7-inch stick pins that we carry in our store. And these are really long for me, especially for this project. So what I did is I snipped it a little to the length that I wanted with the wire cutter. And these are filigrees, and I'm just going to kind of bend that. A little in half. I'm just going to put a little small hole right in the center of this. You see that? But I put a hole in there so that I can kind of get my stick pin in there. If that makes any sense to you. But make sure I wiggle it in. See? Like that. Then I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to make sure I stick it in there really good, and I'm going to take some of this stuff that's really, it's already all over my hand. I'm going to grab these here, and I'm just going to, these prongs, hold it there, and then I'm going to take my beads. Sorry, I gotta move these over here. So I had different types of beads that I had laying around here. And I'll go ahead and start with maybe a flower there. My hand because this thing is gummy and sticky. Okay, so put that there. And slide this in. And then I'll grab a bead and do the same thing. My next one, make sure I got the right size. And I'm going to take these two pieces of filigrees. And before I do that, I want these to be, make sure it goes in. Yep. So we're going to put that there. A little bit of this in there. Get it to stick, slide it up too, and then I'm going to go ahead and place that between these two. Like that. Now, just keep in mind, you don't have to make them this short. You can make them, just leave them as long. I didn't want them that long, to be honest. So, sandwich these two together. And then what I will do is take another one of my little prongs. In place so that those two can dry up really good and set that aside, and then I'll come in and put an image or something there. So that's that one. And then for this one, I'll snip it as well. Maybe not as short. Small little bead, and make sure it fits in before you do anything. Make sure it always fits in. Sometimes the bead holes are a little bit snug or tight or not big enough, and you can get something to make the bead hole just a little bit bigger. And then slide your spacer. Clean it up before it actually dries up, so it will stay like that. And I know it says dries clear. I put plenty down here. And I have these that I picked up and I don't know, remember where, because it's been a while. It's been probably about 2 years. It just tells you how long it's been. Fits in there really snug, and that bead locks in. So I'm going to put some here as well, and slide this in. This is just like building a little, it's however you want to build it. I don't notice that my body is kind of long, so let's go with this one. I want that really seeped in there with lots of glue, so that it doesn't come undone. And then, if you really want to lock it in place, the best thing to do is add a smaller bead at the end, and that way you start with a bead and you end with a bead, but it's small, and that'll help lock it in place as well. But I don't know if you can see my hands, I get really grody with this bead glue. But it does the job, so we'll keep it because it does the job. I got a ton of little beads here that I'm going to go through. I want that to lock in. So that is one pin. They are heavy, so make sure you put plenty of glue in there. That's really important. I'm going to put more up here so that really sticks in there. Okay, so we'll set that aside. And then, now at Hobby Lobby, I picked these up at the bridal section. And you can work with these as well, which is what I did on some other pins that I did. And it's the same concept, just the smaller territory you're working with. So we're going to put more dab in there. eraser. Grab your bead. Before we put that bead in, I want to put some tons of glue in here. Figure out how I want these placed before I even try to do anything else. I'm going to go ahead and put this one in. That. And then I'll finish up with the smaller bead at the end. That's pretty much it. It's not a whole lot that you're doing. I wanted to do something as well. You see these little pieces of remnants that we have laying here? That as like, you know, it was a piece of a beaded dangling thing. And then we're gonna go and put more here. As I was seeing that, but that I thought that would be cute, you know, just an alternative. So these will sit here for a little bit. Now I'm going to go back to this one. Had an idea for this, so let's work on that. This one, sorry, this is taking a while, but I want to give you guys a different variation of how to create some of these. Now, I had this that I picked up at Michael's, about a year ago. It's been a long time. But I thought if I stuck one of these in and use it as a stick pin, I thought that would be fabulous. It would be cute. The work was almost already done for me. So all I had to do is kind of trim this out because it's too long. And wiggle it in there somewhat and play around with it and get a stick pin for my little shoe. So that's what we're going to do. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. And I'm going to put a lot of this stuff because I want it to stick in there. And these aren't really hard to make, but when I'm looking at them, they're pretty easy to make. Just kind of hold it in place like so. Let you have it kind of try and see what it's, if it has a hole. It does have a hole, but I want that to make sure it doesn't come out. And then stick it together. And hope for the best that this is going to be a stick pin that we can use, just like so, on our little shoe. So, let's hope for it, ladies. Hopefully it'll work. Hopefully it will work. It will if I kind of got this head from wobbling. So let's stick some glue in here. And kind of get that head straight a little. And then leave her there to dry up. Going back to this one, it should be kind of dry. A little bit wiggly, not quite yet. But what I'm going to do is take a metal embellishment, well, a bling, actually. And I have these little bottle cap stickers that I picked up at Hobby Lobby, so I'm going to put that on one side. And then on this side, what I'm going to do, I'm going to put some hot glue here, and you can put some of that quick dry as well, and I'm just going to stick that right there, just like so, and get this here, isn't that cute? Maybe at the back as well, and then we'll put it on this one's almost dry, not quite, but that's going to go like that on my shoe. Oops. Didn't have that much glue, so they can pretty much go right in our shoe. Like that. Like that. Yeah, it was still kind of dry. It's dry enough because I put a lot more in there. Stinking cute. It's so cute. There's all that going on. The glare with my, you know, we have all the little charms hanging down from her side of the shoe. It's so dark. And then I'm going to go ahead and pop some hot glue in here, get that sticker done. And then here, I'm going to put that right in the smack in the center of that. Stick pins, including this one that's like a little trim one, and then that one, and then we have these that we're working on that's drying up, and I'm hoping this one turns out great, because I think that would be cute as a stick pin. If we were to put that right there, oh, wouldn't she be cute? Okay, so we're going to let her sit for a bit, but anyway, that is it. That is the tutorial on how to alter your baby shoes. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Until next time, give me thumbs up if you like this video. If you have any questions, send me a message. Check us out on Facebook. We do have a group, Creating with Details group, and we also have an online store called creatingwithdetailsstore.com. Until next time, take care, be nice, be kind to others, and God bless you guys. Bye-bye.